know you are for me, but sometimes it's hard to believe that you're working things out for me. But I can't see, I can't see. I'm walking with blindfolds on, but you're more sure than the ground that I stand on.
You fell for that. JC Youth, welcome back to JC Youth Online. Online youth groups at Journeys Crossing. Thank you so much for hanging out with us today. It was so cool of you. If it's your first time here, let's do some introductions. My name is Scott, and I'm the youth pastor at JC. What is going on, everybody? We are in week two of our new series at JC Youth Online called The Haves and the Have-Nots. And we wanted to start you out today with a question. So here's your question. Who's your favorite famous person right now? Is it an athlete, a YouTuber, Instagrammer, TikToker, maybe a movie star? Who's your favorite famous person right now? So join us in the live chat right over there. You've got 60 seconds. Let us know who your fave celeb is. Okay, ready? Go. Nicely done. Okay, that was step one. Now let's see how good you are at identifying some famous people. Maybe you'll be as good as these four girls. Let's watch Pie in the Face Celebrity Edition. Hey everybody. Okay, so we're gonna try something. This is called Pie in the Face. I've got four contestants, Mimi, Mildred, Lizzie, and Maddie, and they're gonna come up and they're gonna try to guess the contestants, the celebrities that we're gonna show them on the screen at these two tables. Now, if they guess it right, no big deal. If they're the first one to guess it, they're all good. If they guess it wrong, or if they're the second person to guess, they get a pie in the face. Okay, let's go. All right, girls, this is called Pie in the Face. Now, Pie in the Face is really, really simple. You've got to guess the celebrity first, and you don't get hit in the face with a pie. If you don't guess the celebrity first, you're getting a pie in the face. All right, so next slide is this. This is our test slide. Who is that? Okay, so if we were actually going, Lizzie, you would catch a pie in the face. These are our two contestants, our first two contestants. Madison over there, there's Madison, and there is Lizzie over there. Hello, Lizzie. Okay, so this is Will Smith. Next, this is another test. Okay, let's see who would get this one. Ooh, that would have been a tie. Who would have got that one, Mildred? Maddie? Okay, Maddie. All right, so Maddie, it's not Will Smith. It's not really Will Smith. It's really Drake. Okay, so now that you understand how to play, are you ready to play? You ready to play Pie in the Face Celebrity Edition? Here we go. On the count of three, the first name is coming up. One, two, three. Who was it? Lizzie was first. Madison gets the pie in the face on the count of three. Three, two, one. Yes! Well done. Very nice, ladies. Okay, our next contestants are Mimi and Mildred. All right, so are you girls ready? Pie in the face. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. What? Chris who? What's his last name? What's his last name? Oh! Hemsworth! That's right! Chris Hemsworth. So, Mimi, I'm sorry, but you get the pie in the face. You're not gonna believe this, but I didn't hit record. Oh no, I did hit record. All right, so far, Mimi's got a pie and Maddie's got a pie. Okay, here we go. These are our two winners from the first two rounds, Lizzie and Mildred. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. Oh, who was it? Who was it?
She got the rock first.
I will take the rock. Yeah, you got it. I think it's Lizzie. Lizzie, you get the pie in the face. 3, 2, 1. Do it. Oh, very good. All right, next contestants are Mimi and Maddie. So, Mimi, Maddie, and Lizzie all have one pie. Here we go. 3, 2, 1, go. Oh, Maddie is not good at this game. All right, here we go. 3, 2, 1, pie in the face. Oh my gosh. That's a good one. All right, okay, so we've got Maddie with two pies, we've got Mimi with one, and Lizzie with one. Mildred's got no pies. Way to go, Mildred. All right, so Selena Gomez, here's the next pie in the face celebrity.
Maya
Hayes. Oh, sorry. Maya Hayes. Well done, Mildred. 3, 2, 1. First pie in the face for Mildred. Very nice. Well done, my friend. All right, all of our players have at least 1 point. Maddie's got two. Here we go, next one. Bonus round, here we go. Who is it? Arnold Schwarzenegger. You are so not right. You both get a pie in the face. That is Teddy Roosevelt. You both get a pie in the face. Let's do it. Arnold Schwarzenegger, yes. Go, 3, 2, 1, go. Very nice. All right, guys, we're here in the bonus round. We've got, everybody has two except for Mildred. Everybody has two pies except for Mildred. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. Yes! Sorry, Lizzie. Steve Matthews. 3, 2, 1, go. Nicely done. Yes. All right, here it is. This is it. This is for all the marbles because Mildred, if she gets this right, wins our pie in the face challenge. Mimi can stay ahead of these two girls, but if Mimi gets the point, Mildred gets the point, then we have like a three-way tie. So we're not know what we're gonna do. All right, here we go. 3, 2, 1, boom. It's a dog. Whose dog? What's the name of this dog? Anybody know? Anybody know? This is our dog, Panda. Oh, you both get a pie in the face. Let's see, 3, 2, 1, go. Oh, so sorry, girls. Well done. We're gonna declare, because we're sort of unfair, we're gonna declare Mildred the winner. Well done, Mildred. Nicely done. Give it up for all of our contestants. Thanks for playing, girls.
Okay, that was pretty awesome. Thank you, girls. I
don't know about you, but a lot of the famous people I admire have lives, opportunities, qualities, and possessions that I kind of wish I had. Whether it's a famous athlete, YouTuber, Instagram influencer, or movie star, part of the reason we love to follow these people is that we wish we were like them in some way. Maybe we want to be like these people in a good way. Maybe they inspire us because of their character, values, intelligence, or skill. But sometimes we want to be like people for ways that aren't so healthy. Maybe we compare ourselves to them and think, if only I could dress more like them, have as much money as they have a body or face like theirs, be as talented or connected as they are. We might think, if only I could have what that person has, then maybe I'd be more lovable or valuable than I am. I get it. It's human to compare ourselves with others, to worry about how we measure up, and to want to be loved and liked. This month, we want to help you think about who you are in a new way. We want to help you focus less on what you think you don't have, so you can better see what you already have. Last week, we talked about the first thing each of us has, and why that thing is so valuable. You have a past. We said our past has helped shape who we are into who we are today, but that your past doesn't have to define you. You have today, and your today is valuable if you choose to let God use it. But it's not always easy to focus on today or be present in the moment. Sometimes we get stuck reliving the exciting or embarrassing parts of our past.
So one of my friends tonight sent me a TikTok sermon, and the pastor said in the sermon, "The devil reminds us of our past when he is afraid of our future." I'm going to be real. Satan hates to see you on fire for God. He hates to see all of us on fire for God. He hates to see us worshiping God. He hates to see us reading our Bibles. He hates to see us even talking about him. So that's why he reminds us of our past. That's why he reminds us of all the shameful things that we've done. But y'all, there's good news. It says in Jeremiah 31, "For I will forgive their iniquity and never again remember their sin." It says in Psalm 103, "As far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our transgressions from us." So when we ask God for forgiveness, he literally forgets our sin. So y'all, praise God tonight for that. He is so good.
Sometimes we spend all our time dreaming or worrying about the future.
The past is a memory. It's a thought arising in the present. The future is merely anticipated. It is another thought arising now.
When we spend too much time focusing on what happened in the past or what could happen in the future, we miss out on the opportunity to engage with what God has for us right now.
Hey guys, it's Edwin. Last week we introduced you to a Hebrew man named Moses. If you remember, the dude was supposed to be killed as a baby by the Egyptian government, but instead he was adopted by the Pharaoh's family, the same rulers who had tried to kill him and had enslaved his people. When Moses grew up, he killed the man who was abusing a Hebrew slave and then fled the country. Let's pick up the story where we left off.
In the famous story of the burning bush, God appears to Moses and commissions him to go to Pharaoh and order him to release the Israelites. And God says that he knows Pharaoh will resist, and so he will bring his judgment on Egypt in the form of plagues. Then God also says that he will harden Pharaoh's heart. And so we're introduced into the next main part of the story, the confrontation between God and Pharaoh.
Exodus 3:1-14. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, "I'll go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up." When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called him from within the bush, "Moses, Moses!" And Moses said, "Here I am." "Do not come any closer," God said. "Take off your sandals, for the place where you're standing is holy ground." Then he said, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, "I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I've heard them crying out because of their slave drivers. I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the land of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me. I've seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go. I'm sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you. And this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they asked me, what is his name? And what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are going to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you.
Moses was being asked to partner with God to free the Israelites, Moses' own people, from the Egyptians' enslavement. Moses' past lined up perfectly with what God was calling him to do in that moment. The Israelites were Moses' people, but Moses also had a relationship with the Egyptian rulers, thanks to his childhood. With this invitation, God was letting Moses know that his past could be redeemed. However, it's clear from his excuses and questions that Moses was too stuck in the past and future to see the opportunity God had for him in the present. I'm guessing Moses felt some regret about his past. I mean, after all, he did kill a guy, as well as some fear about his future. What would happen if he had returned to Egypt?
Exodus 3:15, 19-20, and 4:1-5. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name you should call me from generation to generation. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand compels him to. So I will stretch out my hand and strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I will perform among them. After that, he will let you go. Moses answered, what if they do not believe me or listen to me and say, the Lord did not appear to you? Then the Lord said to him, what is that in your hand? A staff, he replied. The Lord said, throw it on the ground. Moses threw it on the ground and it became a snake, and he ran from it. Then the Lord said to him, reach out your hand and take it by the tail. So Moses reached out and took hold of the snake, and it turned back into a staff in his hand. This, said the Lord, is so that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has appeared to you.
In the passage, Moses didn't feel equipped to do what God was asking him to do. But do you see what God asks? What's in your hand? Now, I don't know exactly what God is asking me to do today. Maybe God is asking you to take a risk, or to be obedient, or to change a habit in your life. Maybe you're not sure what God is asking you to do just yet, but whatever God is asking you to do today, could it be that God has already given you the tools you need to do it? Could God use you just as you are, right now, with what you have, to make a difference? Could God be saying to you, you are ready, you are called, and you are enough, right here and now?
Thanks, Edwin. All right. So now, to get ready for what we're going to be doing here in a few moments, you're going to need a couple of things. One is a Bible, a physical Bible. Do you know what those are anymore? They look like this. They've got paper inside them with words. This is mine. This is my physical Bible. You're going to need one, okay? You're also going to need a pen. Even better, if you have highlighters like you use in school, do you have those? Okay, so take 2 minutes and go and find your Bible and a pen or a highlighter or both. Now, if you only have a Bible app on your phone, you can use that too, as long as you know how to highlight in it. And while you're looking, what if chickens had arms? Wow. Okay, so hold on to those items for a few minutes and let's talk a little more. All right, so whether you follow Jesus or not, I'm guessing you know what it's like to feel stuck when you really should be focusing on taking your next step in life. Maybe you're focused on the past, wishing you made different decisions or regretting things you've said or you've done. And if that's you, listen to what the Apostle Paul writes about how Jesus redeems us from our past and prepares us for everything that God has for us.
Ephesians 2, 4 through 10, "But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do."
Here's the thing. Through Jesus, you are God's masterpiece. Like, your past is made new through him. Your sins are erased through him. And now God invites you on a mission today. Like, maybe you're focused on the future, thinking you have a long way to go before God can use you, or that maybe you're not old enough or ready enough or allowed to do something meaningful today. But if that's you, listen to what John writes about the kind of life Jesus came to give us. And my buddy Owen is going to read it to us. Owen, take it away.
John 10:10. "The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." Hi,
Owen. Nice job, bud. Well done. All right, so both now and into eternity, Jesus says that you've got an enemy. And here he calls him the thief. The Bible has a bunch of names for him: Satan, Lucifer, the devil, or maybe some you've heard. And according to Jesus, he's real. And he's your enemy, and he hates you, and he tries to steal from you. But Jesus came to give you a life that's full and abundant, and he invites you to join him today, not someday, but today in that kind of life. I want to tell you a couple of truths about today. Today, God loves you just as you are. Today, you are exactly who you need to be in order to be used by God. Does that mean you have it all together, that you're without sin? No. But God can still use you. Today, you are exactly where you need to be in order to be used by God. Have you made mistakes or maybe lost your way a little bit? Yeah, could be. But God can still use you. Today, you have what you need in order to do what God is inviting you to do. And today, you have another chance to know Jesus and live for him. You have today. Today's a gift. So take it. Take the gift. I'm not sure what God is asking you to do today. Maybe God's inviting you to, I don't know and follow Jesus for the first time. Maybe you're being asked to be baptized into him. Maybe he's asking you just to be more obedient in your life, to take his leading more seriously and to live according to it because you trust him. Maybe he's asking you to make some kind of big change or to take a stand or show somebody love. There's a lot of ways that God might be calling us to do something today. So instead of living in the past or the future, maybe live in today. Like, do something with him and for him today. And sometimes before we know and are ready to do what God tells us to do, maybe we have to know who we are. Like, imagine how your life would change if you believed that God loved you just as you are right now, today. What if you believed that you were loved? What would change? What would you start doing? What would you stop doing? How would you see or treat yourself differently? How would you see or treat others differently? Would you start to treat today like the gift that it is? All right, so you have your Bibles and pens from earlier. I want you to look up a passage of scripture. It's Psalm 139 in your Bibles or on your phones. The book of Psalms is pretty much the middle of the Bible. Like, look, boom, middle of the Bible, Psalm 139. I want you to read Psalm 139. And as you do, I want you to write down or underline key phrases from that passage that tell you about who God thinks you are. We're going to give you 5 minutes to do it. Anything you see in there about who God says you are and how he feels about you. Ready? Go.
Look, guys, today is a gift from God, but you won't be able to live that life until you're convinced that God loves you. And in a world where we constantly compare ourselves with other people, it can be hard to believe that you're valuable and loved just like you are, but you are. You are valuable and loved right now, right here, as you are. You're at an age where you're trying to figure out who you are and what you can do and what your future's about. And it can be difficult to believe that you can make a difference in the world, but you can. You can do something for God and for others with the tools that you've already been given. You have today, and your today is valuable. So as we close up today's JC Youth Online, what are you going to do with it? Dalit's going to lead us in prayer, and I'll be right back.
Let's pray together. God, thank you. Thank you so much for your love. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you for making me who I am. Thank you for making each one of our youth who they are. Thank you for making them special and unique. Thank you, God, because I know that they're in your hands, and I know that you will help each one of us find what we're good at and what you've made us for. God, thank you. Thank you for making me valuable. Thank you for being the one who is always there. Thank you for being the all-powerful, the I am, the one who covers it all. Thank you because we know that just like Moses, we're not going to walk alone. We are powerful, and we have talents and gifts that will help us be who you want us to be in this world and do what you want us to do because you are with us every step of the way. Thank you, God, for that. Thank you because I don't compare to anybody else. I was made to do what you want me to do. And I just want to do that, Lord. And I pray that in our hearts, in the hearts of every single one of our youth, of our youth leaders, we will have that desire to be who you want us to be, and that we also have our hearts filled and our minds filled with that knowledge that you are with us every single step of the way. Lord, thank you. Thank you for this day. Please help make us love others as you love us. Be there for others as you are there for us. And give us a great, fantastic week to share your love. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Thanks, Dalit, for leading us in prayer. And really, thanks, everybody, for hanging out with us today at JC Youth Online, week two of the haves and the have-nots. It's been great. Big thanks to Mimi and Mildred, Lizzie and Maddie for helping us out with that game. That was amazing. You guys really took one for the team. And Owen, thank you, bro, for reading scripture for us. You rock, dude. Good job. Next week, we'll be back with week three of this series. Today, we talked about the today that you have because of God in your life. And next week, we'll talk about something else you have because of God working stuff out in your life. Really good stuff. Be a part of JC Youth Online next week. And don't miss out on tonight's JC Youth Live. Weather permitting, we'll be meeting on the back patio from 5 to 6:30 here at Journeys Crossings building. If you're coming, you've got to register. You guys have been doing so well. Props to you. You've been doing so well with registering. And because it was such a big hit last week, we're busting out the fire pit again, this time for roasted hot dogs. So bring your roasting stick, your like professional roasting sticks that you all seem to have. How many of you, is that a thing? I never had one of those in my life. It's amazing. Okay, so if you're coming tonight, you'll find the link to register in the description below this video. Hit that up and invite a friend to come with you. JC Youth Live has been amazingly good. So be a part of it tonight. And if you're gonna invite them, send them the link for today's JC Youth Online so they can watch today sometime and be even more in on the conversation tonight. Have them go to our JC YouTube page. That's youtube.com/journeyscrossing. They'll find the whole JC Youth YouTube playlist. They can watch on our Insta page today afternoon, Journeys Crossing YM. They can check it out there. And here's all of our contact info. You can call us, email us, text us. Our websites are here, ilovethischurch.com/youth, and our newer website, jcyouthonline.com. Here's our social media. We've got Insta, Twitter, and Facebook. And on Insta, Monday through Friday, we do this prayer time at noon called Insta Prayers. We'd love for you to go there and pray along with us. All right, well, see you tonight at JC Youth Live, 5:30 to 6, 5 o'clock till 6:30 on our back patio at Journeys Crossings building for hot dogs and good conversation. And really, what else do you need in life? All right, so love you guys. Have a great week. Peace. We are out.
Even when I can't see the full plan.